I am Deepak Dhungri from UDAAN Class 10 Rapid Revision Class. Today, I am going to discuss on a topic that is our environment. Let us begin. Okay, so in this we will study all these topics. So first, let us start with an activity. See, collect waste materials from your home. That is, this could include all the waste generated during the day, like kitchen waste, all solid waste, municipal waste, vegetable waste, steel use, everything. So what are the materials that remain unchanged over a long period of time? That is the plastic, bubble packs, milk packets, empty cartons, etc. They remain unchanged, means they will remain as it is for a long period of time. But there are perishable goods that will be left changed, means they will change during the course of time. For example, vegetable peels, spoiled food, used steel use, waste paper, all those, they change their form. Of these materials that are changed, which one changed the fast? That is the cotton racks, vegetable peels, used steel use, waste paper, they change very faster. Now let us begin. Why are many man-made materials like plastic do not broken down? Because see, plastics are those which are non-biodegradable substances. We'll see this in later course. See, first you should know that the specific enzymes are needed to break down of the particular substance. So in order to break down this plastic, we need specific enzymes to break down into simple components. So here, who will break down the natural things or biodegradable things? That is bacteria. See, bacteria and the saprophytes do not have enzymes to broken down materials like plastic. So for plastic, there are no particular specific enzymes or bacteria or sporophytes, so they will live for a long time and they are non-biodegradable. So what are biodegradable substances? See, biodegradable substances are those which will undergo or mix with the soil itself. For example, if you throw a paper today, again it will be mixed with the soil and you doesn't get it back. Similarly, biodegradable substances are those which can be broken down by the biological processes such as bacteria. So substances that are broken down by the biological processes, by the process of bacterial decomposition, they are said to be biodegradable substances. For example, all natural substances or nature provided substances are biodegradable substances. For example, paper, vegetable waste, cotton materials, etc. Then what are non-biodegradable or all man-made or the artificial substances are nothing but the non-biodegradable substances. So how do we define this? See, substances that are not broken down by the biological processes or by the bacteria are said to be non-biodegradable substances. Example, rubber, plastic, glass. These substances, what you can see here, are they are very harmful to the nature when they are burnt, and they neither be degraded by the bacterial decomposition also. Then non-biodegradable substances or non-biodegradable waste generated daily in the kitchen which can be recycled. So you can see all those which can be recycled here are given. See, broken plastic containers or the water bottles can be recycled, polythene bags or the plastic bags can be recycled, and this is aluminium wrapper, all those tin foils can be recycled. So how do you distinguish between the biodegradable and non-degradable substances? See, those substances which can be broken down into simple substances by biological process are biodegradable, similarly which cannot be decomposed by the biological process. So biodegradable substances, they do not produce more pollution, whereas non-biodegradable substances like plastic, all those, they produce more pollution. Biodegradable substances, they remain for less time in the environment, after which they go mix with the nature or the soil. But non-biodegradable substances, they remain for a very long time in the environment, and there is a chances of pollution also. Then how do these biodegradable substances affect the environment? See, these biodegradable substances are the natural substances act as a medium to return back the nutrients to the environment. Again, they will give back all the nutrients to the environment. For example, if a living being is died, again if it is buried in the soil, then again his nutrients is taken up by the bacterial decomposition, again it is reused over a period of time. So there is the biodegradable substances, they return back the nutrients to the environment. Similarly, their degradation may release certain gases in the atmosphere. Sometimes the fossil fuels, what you can study, over a very long period of time, in hundreds of millions of years. So after burning those fossil fuels, there is chances that they can pollute the environment. Then how do these non-biodegradable substances affect the environment? See, the non-biodegradable substances, they make the environment very poisonous and they make the environment unsuitable to survive. So they block the transfer of energy and minerals in the ecosystem. For example, you can see the polymeric materials, cotton, paper, rope, and you can see the paper, it takes 2 to 5 months for degradation. Whereas the glass bottles and plastic, you can see the glass bottle, it is 1 million years in order to degrade it or decompose. But plastic bottles, they have estimated it is never ever. So it is very unhygiene to use these substances because they are nature harming. Whereas paper, rope, orange with natural substances, using them for a short time is good. So what are the advantages of paper bags over paper bags natural nature given than plastic bags during shopping? See, paper bags can be recycled. Remember, paper bags can be recycled. During recycling of these paper bags, it does not produce any poisonous gases like plastic bags. If plastic bags are burnt, then they give very harmful gases to the environment. Similarly, the paper bags are biodegradable. That means again they can be decomposed by the bacterial decomposition, and they do not pollute the environment as in case of plastic bags. Yes. Next, why is the government stressing upon the use of jute or cloth carrying bags? Because jute or cloth bags are biodegradable and they do not harm the nature. Yes, during recycling. And they do not pollute environment on disposal also. Then what are the harmful effects of using plastic bags on the environment? One by one we'll list. You can see here the picture depicts how this the waste material, plastic bags are dumped at the one site, and due to which the soil where they are buried, that becomes barren, that becomes waste, and it leads to again the soil pollution also. Then second thing, it jams all these drainages, so and it will cause the air pollution surrounding and foul smells, and that will lead to the mosquitoes or the spread of the diseases. Then on burning these, they releases very harmful and toxic gases that causes the pollution and global warming too. Then what are the alternatives you can use instead of using plastic? You can use this plastic bags. Instead of plastic bags, you can use cloth bags, paper bags, jute bags to carry the purchased items. Then what is, now we'll start discussion regarding our ecosystem. So ecosystem is nothing but the component, both living and non-living component, both comprises of the ecosystem. See, all the interacting organisms in the area together with living and non-living constitutes the environment, and that constitutes the ecosystem. So there are two components of ecosystem, that is biotic component. That biotic means living components, for example plants, animals, microorganisms, and abiotic components, that is physical factors like temperature, rainfall, rivers, winds and minerals. Then can we consider garden as an ecosystem? Yes. See, a garden has a different plants, such as it has grasses, trees, flower bearing plants like rose, jasmine, sunflower, and even a garden has animals like frogs, insects and birds. So this both considering of this plants, animals and all these living organisms interact with each other, and their growth, reproduction and other activities are affected by the abiotic component of the ecosystem. So then what are the two types of ecosystem again? Natural ecosystem and artificial. See, natural ecosystem is the nature made ecosystem, for example forest, ponds and lakes. What are artificial ecosystems? Are the human made ecosystem, for example gardens, the crop fields is nothing but agriculture, are the example of this artificial ecosystem, or even the aquarium which you keep in your home. Then can we consider aquarium as an ecosystem? Yes. See, the aquatic plants would make the food from the available light in this aquarium. The food can be used by the fishes, so the food chain is formed. Why should we need to clean the aquarium? See, an aquarium does not have adequate number of decomposers. That is, an small aquarium, if you take in your home, that do not have more amount of bacterial decomposers in it for the waste to decompose, and so it has to be cleaned once in a while. Increase in the nutrients due to the decomposition causes algae growth, which causes limited water of the aquarium, cloudy or opaque, and growth of the bacteria. So this harms the fish population in the aquarium. You can see the algae formation here and the opaque substance, which is leading to harm the fishes in it. Then, should we clean ponds and lakes also? No. See, plants and lakes have enough varieties of decomposers in it, that is the bacteria in it, which can decompose waste organic material and complete the biochemical cycles. Then we shall study water producers. See, all green plants, who will produce the food? Only the plants are the one who produces the food. So all green plants and certain blue green algae which can produce food by photosynthesis are called as producers. Then water consumers, see, there are three types of consumers: primary consumers, secondary consumers, tertiary consumers. Okay, so the primary consumers are nothing but the herbivores who can directly eat the plants. Then carnivores are the secondary consumers who feed on these herbivores, and omnivores are those who eat both plants, herbivores and carnivores. And scavengers are nothing but they eat bodies of dead and decaying organisms. So the organism which consume the food produced directly or indirectly from the other organism, we call it as a consumers. So what are decomposers? See, the microorganisms that break down the complex organism, for example bacteria, so into the simple inorganic compounds are called as decomposers. For example, worms, mushrooms, insects, or the most commonly are the bacteria. What will happen to the garbage and the dead animals and plants in the absence of decomposer? Definitely there is no recycling of these nutrients takes place, such as the nutrients present in them are nitrogen, phosphorus and sulfur, etc. All biodegradable wastes, that is garbage, dead animals and plants, will accumulate and cause environmental pollution. In absence of decomposers, the earth would be piled up with the dead remains of the plants and animals. What is the role of decomposers or the bacteria here? See, decomposers helps in the breakdown of this organic matter or the living components or the biomass from the body of the dead plants and animals into simple inorganic raw materials such as carbon dioxide, water and some nutrients. Then we shall discuss this small activity. Write the aquatic organisms in order of who eats whom and form a chain at least three steps. See, plants are eaten by small fishes and small fishes are eaten by the large fishes. So what is the food chain? See, the series of organisms that are taking part in the biotic levels form a food chain. In the first example, you can see a three-linked food chain. A corn is eaten by rat and rat is eaten by owl. Similarly, a four-linked food chain, a carrot is eaten by the rabbit, a rabbit is eaten by fox, and fox is eaten by the lion. That means a carrot is eaten by herbivorous, herbivorous is eaten by carnivorous, carnivorous can be eaten by omnivore, or something. The kind of logic is primary consumer, secondary consumer and tertiary consumer. We call this as topic level 1, 2 and 3. Similarly, the grass is eaten by the grasshopper, the primary consumer, frog, secondary consumer, python, tertiary consumer, fifth consumer is eagle. Then the food chain, what we can indicate here is the grass, deer, tiger. These are some of the examples you can see here. So which are found in forest, grasslands and pond. In the pond you can see the phytoplankton is eaten by scorpion. Again the scorpion is eaten by the fish, fish is eaten by the crane. Now what are trophic levels? See, each step you can see here, the each step of the food chain forms a trophic level. The bottom most are producers. See, you can see the triangle is wider here, the portion is wider because there are more amount of producers. Then but all plants, producers are usually the plants, but all plants is not eaten by these primary consumers, they are herbivorous. So herbivorous population is less than the consumers. Similarly, secondary consumers, you can assume it as carnivorous who eat these primary consumers, and tertiary consumers can be omnivorous or the bacterial decomposers. Okay, then how does the loss of energy in the tropic levels takes place? See, when the green plants are eaten by the primary consumers, some amount goes into the digestion, okay? And in doing work, and rest goes towards the growth and reproduction. There is a loss of flow of energy. So average value of the organic matter that is present at each tropic level is 10%. So 10% is the average amount of organic matter that is present at each tropic level and that reaches to the next level of consumers. That means if the producers has 100%, only the 10% is taken by the primary consumers and 10% it is taken by secondary and 10%. So only the 10% of energy can be flown from further higher topic levels. Then why do food chains consists of only 3 or 4 steps? Since only 10% of energy is available, as I told earlier, only the each topic level has only 10% for the next level of consumers. Food chains generally consists of only 3 or 4 steps. So the loss of energy at each step is so much that very little usable energy remains at the fourth level, so you cannot be surviving with that level of energy. Then what is 10% law? See, the 10% law tells that, see, the plants trap 1% of the solar. In this, you can see if there is a sun here, energy from the sun, and the plants will take, and the plants will take from 1% only, the plant takes only 1%, okay? So if the sun is here and the primary consumers are the plants, if you assume they are 100% and it will take only 1% of it, that means you assume that primary consumers is having 100%, and the second is taken by 10%, then it will be taken by 1%, 10% of it, then 0.1%, 0.01%. So this is how the flow of energy takes place. So the plants tap 1% of the solar energy and only 1% of the solar energy, sorry, and only 10% of the available energy is transferred from one tropic level to the next tropic level. So this is, we call it as 10% law. In the following food chain, grass provides 4000. So grass is nothing but the tropic level 1, that is the producers, 4000 joules of energy to the grasshopper. So second, how much energy will be available to the snake and the frog? See, as per the 10% law of transfer of energy through the tropic levels, frogs will get 400. See, for 4000 is here, okay, if it will from grass, the grasshopper will have 4000. So 10% of 4000 is 400 is taken by the frogs, and 10% of 400 is 40 joules that is taken by the snake. What will happen if we kill all the organisms in one tropic level? See, if we kill all the organisms in one tropic level, the lower tropic level will grow more in number. That means the tropic level 1, you assume the plants, they grow more in number, and the higher tropic level above it will not survive, and the flow of energy from one tropic level to the other tropic level will not be continued. So what is food web? A series of branching you can see here, which shows the relationship in food chains, is called as food web. So here butterfly, you can see the primary consumers, the producers, the plants here, they are eaten by the primary consumers, that is the butterfly, fruit fly, again they are eaten by frog. Different organisms will have the different adaptability to take the food, so this is called food web. So one more example you can see here, the how does the consumption takes place between the different levels of organisms. Then difference between the food chain and food web. See, food chain is nothing but the sequence of one organism consuming. Here we'll see only the one level, one flow, and in food web we see the network of the food chain which intercrosses the and linkages takes place. And here the topic level of the each organism is fixed. Each organism at a tropic level receives food from only one group of organism, but in food web each organism in one tropic level receives its food from more than one group of organism. Then why is the flow of energy unidirectional? Why does there is a flow of energy taking place from producers to the higher levels only? That is why it is in only one direction. See, the energy that is captured by the autotrophs, that is the plants, do not revert back to the solar input, and the energy which passes to the herbivores does not come back to the autotrophs. So the flow of energy is unidirectional. You can see here the sun is gives the energy to the producers by the process of photosynthesis. Again, that will be taken by the consumers, all the then decomposers, then again inorganic nutrients taken by the producers in presence of sunlight. Then how do pesticides and other chemicals enter the food chain? So here we are talking about the biomagnification process. See, pesticides and other chemicals are either washed down into the soil or into the water bodies. From the soil, these are absorbed by the plants. Obviously, from the soil, the plants will absorb all the chemicals which are flowing along with the pesticides and all, along with the water and minerals, and from the water bodies these are taken up to the aquatic plants and animals. So biomagnification. So what is biomagnification? See, the accumulation of these harmful chemicals in the individuals of higher topic levels is called as biomagnification. You can see the DDTs are the harmful chemical which are washed down along with the soil into this ponds and lakes. So they will accumulate into this soil. For example, DDT is shown here, due to which the aquatic animals, the survival rate will decrease. Then you can see the biomagnification, due to which the harmful chemicals will increase in the higher level. The water, then you can see the harmful chemicals in producers will be 1000, then 10,000. So this is the amount of magnification of DDT, dichlorodifluorotoluene concentration. That is, you can see how it is getting higher at each higher topic level. So what do you think would be the source of pesticides in these food items? See, pesticides are used in crop fields, usually in agriculture, to get rid of pest. We use these pesticides to protect the crops. These pesticides are absorbed by the soil. Plants absorb these chemicals from the soil through the process of xylem and phloem. So water, the xylem is a water conducting tissue through which the soil takes and prepare food. When these green plants are eaten by the humans, they get absorbed by the human body, and the accumulation of this harmful chemical is seen in the human body also. Discuss what methods could be applied to reduce our intake of pesticides. See, all fruits and vegetables must be thoroughly washed under running water, which helps to remove the traces of chemicals and bacteria from the surface. Fruits and vegetables should be peeled if possible. Outer leaves of the leafy vegetables can be removed. And in case of meat, or the fat should be trimmed because some pesticide residues collect in the fat. We can eat organic food or food grown using biological methods of pest management. Then we shall discuss on ozone. See, ozone is oxygen. Three molecules of oxygen, we call it as ozone. You can see the diagram here, oxygen, oxygen, oxygen. Three molecules of oxygen, we call it as, or three atoms of oxygen, we call it as ozone. So ozone is formed in the stratosphere, between stratosphere and troposphere, or in the stratosphere itself most commonly. See, this is the surface of the earth, and there is a troposphere here up to 10 km from the surface of the earth. Then there is a ozone layer present in the stratosphere from 10 to 50 km. Yes, see, what is the role of ozone in atmosphere? See, it protects the harmful, it absorbs the harmful radiations like ultraviolet radiations coming from the sun. See, ozone at higher levels of the atmosphere shields the, it protects, shielding means it protects our earth surface from the ultraviolet radiation from the sun. This radiation is highly damaging to the organisms, like it causes the skin cancers and in the human beings. Then how does this ozone formation takes place? See, ozone, how it will be formed is oxygen, which is present in the air, that breaks down into O plus O. Again, that O again combines with O2 to forms O3. So ozone at a higher level of atmosphere is formed by the UV radiation. You can see the UV radiation is written here, acting on the oxygen molecule. The higher energy UV radiation split apart some molecular oxygen into the free oxygen atoms. These atoms then combine with the molecular oxygen to form ozone. So how does this ozone depletion is taking place there? See, in 1970s you can see the blue color here. In 2013, how does the ozone depletion is taking place? So decrease in the amount of ozone in the atmosphere. So the ozone, the O3 is getting decreased day by day. So that is called as ozone depletion. So what is the reason for this ozone depletion? So decrease in the ozone layer is due to the synthetic chemicals like chlorofluorocarbon, CFCs, which are the used as a refrigerants, and it is used in fire arresting uses and in air conditioners also. Then this activity we'll discuss now, that is which chemicals are responsible for depletion of the ozone layer, that is CFCs. Remember, CFC, chlorofluorocarbons, nitrogen oxides and hydrocarbons are sometimes responsible for the ozone layer depletion. Then find out what happens to the waste generated at home. Is there now, this is about the solid waste management, how to manage the waste, how to decompose the waste and all. Is there a system in a place to collect this waste? See, the waste generated at a home is separated into recyclable and non-recyclable or wet and dry waste. This is collected by the municipal corporation authority and taken to a garbage dump, where it is dumped separately into the recyclable and non-recyclable parts. So you can see how to bifurcate or segregate this wet and dry waste, plastic waste and non-plastic, and recycled waste and non-recyclable waste. Okay, then calculate how much waste is generated at home in a day. See, generally 2 to 3 kg of waste is generated in the home per day. How much of this waste is biodegradable? See, the biodegradable waste are nothing but the fruit peels, leftover food, the waste paper, used steel, that amount to around 1 to 2 kg per day. Calculate how much waste is generated in a classroom in a day. See, classroom waste includes mostly paper, leftover food, wrappers, dust, etc., which amounts to about 750 gram to 1 kilogram per day. How much of this waste is biodegradable? Most of the classroom waste is biodegradable, which is less than 0.5 kg or 500 gram. Suggest ways of dealing with this waste. See, the biodegradable wastes like paper, leftover food items and fallen leaves should be dumped into the compost waste made in a soft corner of the school to prepare compost. The compost can be used in the school garden as a manure. Find out how the sewage in your locality is treated. Are there mechanisms in which to ensure that local water bodies are not polluted by untreated sewage? See, the sewage is collected in drains and sent to the sewage treatment plant, STPs, where it is filtered and treated with the microbes and chemicals to get rid of these waste materials. There are sewage treatment plants which treat water before it is released into the river. Industries are required to treat waste before allowing them to enter the rivers. So you can see here how these sewage treatment plants are located. Yes, then find out how the local industries in your locality treat their waste. See, usually different industries use different methods to eliminate pollutants depending upon the nature of waste. Wastewater is kept in tanks to remove suspended impurities. Wastewater is treated with the different chemicals to remove waste and harmful chemicals. And wastewater is treated with disinfectant like chlorine before allowing it into the rivers. So you can see, are there any mechanism in place to ensure that soil and water are not polluted by the waste? Usually the biodegradable waste is sent for preparation of compost, biogas and manure. So non-biodegradable is used for land refill. So here one more activity they have asked us to search the internet or library to find out the hazardous material have to be dealt with while decomposing the electronic items. How would these materials affect the environment? Dispose electronic items contains cadmium, lead, silicon, plastic, etc. You can see here the telephone waste or the keyboard waste. These items cause land pollution, which can affect our health and also other organisms also. Then find out the plastic that can be recycled. Plastic can be melted and recycled for making plastic bags, mugs, plastic buckets, or molten plastic waste mixed with the asphalt can be used for making roads. Then, does the recycling process have any impact on the environment? Yes, recycling of the plastic fumes of the plastic and during recycling of the plastic fumes of the plastic and other chemicals cause air pollution, which may cause breathing problems like asthma. Yes, and this completes our topic of discussion on our environment. If you are having any discussion or any suggestion, please put it in the comment box. If you like this video, please like it, share and subscribe to our channel. Thank you so much.